Moin. Really happy to be here. My name is Ole and I'm a local, so for me this is a very, very easy one here. This is also why I skipped the party. I assume you're here for all the promises I made. Love, you know, black holes, kittens, and emojis. I really wanna share my favorite emoji with you. That's my favorite. So that's the promise part. So you're gonna leave now. But if you're really interested in fixing your privacy and learning what all the big corps do, I want to talk about DNS over HTTPS. The S here is already really important, but we'll come to this later. In order to understand DNS over HTTPS, I want to first look at the DNS part, because it's crucial to understand DNS in order to understand, you know, the next version of that. So we need to look at the DNS concepts first. DNS is resolving a given domain name to an IP address. So we start with a customer. In order to resolve that address, we need a so-called resolver. So here we have TinyP, our little resolver. And you ask this resolver the domain in question. So I want to resolve dnsymbol.com. But how is the resolver now doing this? Like, as a user, it's like, yeah, it gets magic and I just get an IP address back. And while this holds true, like behind that, there's a lot more going on. So the first thing we need to know, and all of this is with the assumption that there are no caches, and this is obviously false because DNS is just caches and naming things. But in this example, nothing is cached. So the first thing we need is the root server. There's obviously not one super cute root server, but a few. We talk about this too. And the root server knows all the different TLDs that exist, like comnet, org, jobs, works, Vanguard. Like all of these are TLDs. And yes, Vanguard is a TLD. It's a different business. Let's talk about this later. So .com has their own set of name servers. And in this case, they are pretty hairy because they're so old. And then the resolver goes ahead and asks the com name server about this domain that we want to resolve. And then the com name server would say, well, I don't know the actual IP address you asked me for, but I know the DNS server that can resolve that for you. So that's the authoritative DNS server. So here comes Trusty, the authoritative name server in play. And then the resolver goes and just asks the same query again. So do you know dnsymbol.com? And then as this is the authoritative name servers, we hopefully get an IP back or an NX domain if it doesn't exist there. But here we're only looking at the happy path. So now the resolver knows the response, caches it, and all of these parties you see here are caching it. And then the resolver returns us the message. While explaining this took about a minute, in reality, with no caches, it's usually done in milliseconds. So DNS is a pretty fast system. This is also one of its flaws, or one of the reasons why it has a few flaws. This is the general concept of DNS. But also, I want to share how DNS looks on the implementation side, because this is important too. So DNS is a pretty old protocol. It's almost as old as the internet or older. I'll have another example of this in a second. It's defined in RFC 2035. That's the domain names, implementation, and specification. And if you've ever read any RFCs, and this is like a hobby of mine, my guilty pleasure reading RFCs, the old ones are really complex and long. So this is just one flow diagram out of the RFC. And this is basically what I just showed you. The only difference, though, is it shows the resolver locally, so that's a so-called stub resolver, and then the foreign name servers are kind of a black box, as they may appear to your computer, because like, you probably don't know what's going on there. So a very important implementation detail is the so-called resource record. That's the A record, the MX record, CNAME, all of the different domain records you know, they're represented in this format. So they start with a name, then there's a type, the resource record type, which is, you know, A, like AAAA, which is IPv6, CNAME, and all of that. And then there's the class, which I found pretty interesting, because DNS is as old that when the specification was written, it wasn't even clear that the internet, as we know it today, is the succeeding network, right? So when you do a DNS query, they always send the class identifier, which is now in as an internet, but there are others that exist, like the ChaosNet. So in theory, DNS still today supports the ChaosNet architecture, which is a pretty interesting document to read. There's a bad scan PDF from 1981 where they describe the ChaosNet. It was just a few days ago on Hacker News. So this is just one resource record, and then DNS, the protocol that works with message exchanges. So this is one of the message we exchange. There's a question section for the stuff we want to resolve. Then there's the answers, authority, and a few other details that I want to skip for this talk. And last but not least, part of like what DNS really is the DNS transport. And I want to start with a little quiz. So what do you think? What's the transport layer of DNS? Is it TCP? So raise your hand. Is it UDP? Raise your hand. So it's UDP, mostly UDP, unless it's TCP. Because obviously it's not that easy. UDP is not acceptable, for example, for zone transfers, but it's the recommended method for standard queries on the internet. So the most DNS part your computer does will be in UDP. But also, and that's a pretty interesting fact, or I found it funny, like everyone I tell this story says, no, that's not funny, that's just clear. So let's see what you think. Servers can set a truncate bit. So they receive the query and they figure out that the answer will be so long that it wouldn't fit in a UDP datagram. So then the server sends like the best they can from the response and then also say like this is not everything, and they indicate this with a truncate bit, and then the client is required to send the same query but over TCP, where the data fields can grow as they want. But doing this over TCP, you don't have any fixed packet sizes anymore, so the whole protocol shifts by 2 bytes because you have to prefix it with a length. I found this really funny. Okay, let's skip over this. What's wrong with that? So a few things, and in order to understand this, let's take a look on how to resolve a query or how to resolve an IP. So here you see a trace route from my local computer at home. Here you see the trace route from my computer at home to the Google public DNS resolver. So these are like 6 steps in between. The first is my router at home, then there's my ISP, my internet service provider, and then like a few other network providers in between. So my DNS datagram, my UDP package, travels over all of these hops, right? And this is a relatively short route. If you do this like in this network or in a hotel, like in bigger networks, this list can grow to 10 to 20 entries. So they're up to like 10, 20. It can grow unlimited, basically. And all of these parties that are handling your UDP packages, these parties can intercept, analyze, and manipulate your DNS traffic. Now, you don't know the answer you receive if that's what the resolver would want it to send you back. You don't even know if the resolver was actually the one sending it back. You know, you can spoof IP addresses. So all of this can happen, and there's basically no guard in place to anyone fumbling with your DNS. I think this is pretty scary, but this is not it. This is not all of it. So this is just the start. Obviously, not only these parties can intercept your traffic, the resolver also knows what you're querying, right? And this is kind of obvious, so in order to answer your question, I need to know your question. So this is not the super scary part, but I want to take a closer look to the resolver. So other than stated in this super nice graphic, the resolver is not as cute as you might think. So how does your computer know who to talk to resolve a DNS query? So if you've logged into this Wi-Fi here, what happened is that your computer goes out and asks any client on the network, like, who does resolve DNS packages? Like, who can resolve DNS? And any computer in the network can answer, like, I can, right? So I can set up a machine here and fetching all your DNS and manipulate it and send it to my, like, I don't know, Bitcoin mining site, whatever. Like, this is possible in any open network, right? In the best case, though, it's your ISP. Like when you're at home and you trust the network, that's the best case we can get, is sending all of our traffic to our ISP. Also, some of you say, well, I can configure it on my system. And yes, you can. You can have your user-configured DNS. So who does that? Who has the user-configured DNS in the system? Great. Keep your hands open, up. Who of you uses a privately hosted DNS? Keep your hand open. Yeah, so there's one, two hands. That's really great. So you're kind of safe from what all of this what's about to come. Most of you probably just use the resolver of the biggest ad network we have on the planet. And if you're not using that, you're using one of the biggest content delivery networks on the planet, right? So you're giving your browsing data to them for free, right? You don't get anything for that. So I would be really interested in why you're doing that. But that's not the whole resolving chain, right? There are way more parties in here. So next, I want to take a look at the root server. And again, other than stated in this super cute comic, they're not so cute. Right? So DNS root is a pretty complex system. There are exactly 13 root servers, which is not like physical servers, but 13 root names. And they're managed by, unfortunately, only 12 different companies and organizations. So have you ever like asked yourself who's managing that? Like who's seeing all of this internet traffic? Like they probably see a lot of all the browsing data, right? So they should be trustworthy. Have you ever wondered that? I didn't, so I'm guilty myself as well, but I went to an ICANN meeting last year because of part of my job, where they just communicate this pretty openly and they are fine about it. And I was like, wait, not what? So I was really scared and they all just treated like, yeah, that's how it is like 20 years. Oh, shit. So let's look at who's hosting them. So there's VeriSign, fair enough. Like they hosted all of the internet when the like domain space came up, so they hosted .com, all of it, and the rest. There's the University of Southern California. There's Kogan Communications, which is a Delaware-registered nonprofit organization to help the internet. There's the University of Maryland. For those who are not as geographically savvy in the United States, that's really, really, really close to Washington, D.C., which is apparently where the Pentagon is. There are a few more of these in the list. So there's NASA. There's the Internet Systems Consortium, which is another of these, you know, we are nonprofit, but in the U.S. thing. Then there's the U.S. Department of Defense, the U.S. Army Research Lab. What could be wrong with that? There's NetNode, which is a nonprofit independent internet infrastructure organization, so they have more of that. There's VeriSign again, because one of the old managing organizations went out of business, so someone had to take over. There's the RIPE. RIPE is the regional internet registry for Europe, West Asia, and the former USSR. So they had to fit Russia in there somehow. So we have, you know, we have US and the rest, so we just put Russia in the rest. And then there's the ICANN, that's the domain, so that's part of the IANA, so I think these are really the good folks. And then there's the WIDE project. The WIDE project is an internet project in Japan founded by Keio University, Tokyo Institute of Technology, and the University of Tokyo. What do you think? Like, do you feel good about this? I didn't. So, technology is always political. Like, there's no way around that. And I say this because we have seen headlines in the news that people are spraying IP addresses on the houses of walls because they want to like cut down their regime, and the regime wants to cut down their internet because they're organizing like this, and this is the only way to get out of that, by putting all their traffic to the biggest ad network on the planet. Like, this is fucked, right? This shouldn't be like that. There's also the fastest growing like economy on the planet trying to ruin the internet for all of the citizens, and this protocol is how they do it. And then he would say, oh, yeah, you know, this is all the shitty part of the world. Like, I'm living in Europe, so we're pretty privileged. And I think, I want to question you, are you? Like, is that, are we totally free of that? I don't know. Usually the next response is like, well, that's not too bad. Like, I have nothing to hide. And I'm pretty sure you do have something to hide. And if you don't have yet, you may be in a situation in your life where you have. And I really hope that none of you will ever get into these situations. But you know, the internet is such a crucial part of our social system that we shouldn't give it up that easily. So when you say you have nothing to hide, what about you visiting one of these sites? You know, do you want Google to know you're visiting the Rape Crisis Center? Do you want them to know you're visiting the Suicide Prevention Hotline? Do you want them to know that you're visiting Women's Shelter, AIDS Info, like abortion clinics? Like, all of this is public on the internet, right? Everyone that can intercept your traffic, which is pretty easy, can see that. And this is pretty drastic examples, right? Like, this is not, I hope, this is not a website you visit like on a regular basis. But there may be websites that are still, I would have private concerns that are not as drastic as these. For example, you're living on a fixed income. Like, this is not something I want like anyone to know, right? And one of my favorite examples, like, let's pretend you're working at a bank in Germany and you're sitting at your, you know, office network and you're using the internet of your office, and then you're visiting the BaFin whistleblower portal. Like, when your employer is checking the network traffic, like, do you think that's cool? Like, do you really want to know what happens next? Also, you're working at a company where they're trying to cut down that you want to form a workers' union. So what about you visiting their site? Like, there's so many things that I consider private that we are exposing every day, every time. You're having a laptop open, you're having a phone out. All of this is, it's clear text out there, right? And there have been attempts to fix that. So there's DNScript, which is one of my favorite ones because they're so funny. So they don't support multiplexing. They don't reuse connections, so they also use TCP. So every domain I want to resolve, I need to open a new TCP connection and do all the back and forth. So that alone is pretty shitty, but they're not an ITF project, so they don't have an RFC. And I would not consider this a standard at all because of the last two points. So let's forget about DNScript. Like, this is not going like our solution. There is DNS over TLS. So DNS over the Transport Layer Security Protocol, it's fairly recent, it's 3 years old, it's from 2016. And I have 13 minutes left for this talk, so explaining TLS now would be like take way too long. So this is the summary of TLS. It's a lot of magic. How the fuck is he doing that? Like, wow. Okay, that's TLS for today, right? If you want to read up on that. It's pretty cool, but it's really complex. Then you say, well, this is TCP only. How does this fit in the UDP protocol? Well, there is an RFC for that. So there's RFC 4347, which is the datagram transport layer security, which specifies the TLS variant that works over datagram protocols such as UDPs. Okay, right? So this can work. But it also has flaws. And let's see what may be the problem with that. First of all, it's also announced via DHCP. So you can now communicate with the still untrusted, unverified source on your network, but encrypted. So this is just fixing like half of that. So it's not as good as I'd like it to be. Another problem of DOT, so DNS over TLS, is that it runs on a different port because we need to differentiate when it's DNS over TLS and when it's regular DNS. So it runs on 853. And this is already a really big problem because this is usually done optimistically. And if I'm a regime, want to shut down like encrypted DNS, I just shut down this port and then I'm forcing everyone to go back plain text, right? So this is totally not solving the privacy concern. It also only supports pipelining, so it still suffers the head of line blocking, which basically means the slowest request in the queue will block all the following. So there's no multiplexing. And because of that and a few like performance problems in there, or concerns, let's say, it's disabled by default. So what is, like, why are we doing this if we want users to enable it in like hidden menus in your operating system or by, you know, going on the CLI and execute weird commands and probably piping like into sudo bash and all of this stuff? Like, disabling this by default is basically the one reason why this is not a good solution, because when it's not enabled, it's, you know, it's not there. Okay, What about DNS over HTTPS? Like, can this be our savior? First of all, it's only HTTPS, so that's part of the protocol, so it can never be plain text, right? So we have that solved. And it just looks like HTTP. So we have all the good parts from HTTP, and especially HTTP2, like multiplexing, connection reuse, and all of that. And when you think of a modern website that has like all of the tracking and content delivery networks on that, a browser often needs to fetch like 200 different unique domain names, and doing this over a single connection, a single multiplex connection, is pretty fast and pretty resourceful. And what I again found pretty interesting is when you think this further with HTTP 3 or QUIC, we are putting this back from, you know, we put UDP to TCP and then putting it back to UDP, so we're basically going full circle. I think that's pretty cool. Little thought experiment. What if google.com could answer DNS queries? Like, wouldn't this be cool in one way? Actually, this is possible. This is possible right now. So there is undetectable and unblockable DNS, right? Google.com can resolve any queries, and they can do it on the same IP address they host their search engine, right? So let's take a quick look on this code example here. So this is Bert Hubert. He's one of the implementers of PowerDNS. He's a well-known figure in the DNS community. So he starts TCP dump to check any traffic on port 53, DNS port, and 443 HTTPS. And he's resolving the PowerDNS domain via Google, and as you can see, there were no packets captured. So if you're an ISP or any network provider, you have to make, on DNS over HTTPS, you have to make Solomon's choice of either blocking all of google.com, so shutting down the world's most important search engine, and blocking encrypted DNS traffic. So it's basically unblockable. Let's quickly look at an implementation, because this is a tech conference and not a, you know, political event, so I think we should cover this as well. This is defined in RFC 8044, and it's specifying DNS queries over HTTPS or DOE. Like, I spare you all the Homer like DOE gifs, because I've seen it in every talk about this, so I don't want to have this. How does it work? Well, it's HTTP, so if you're seeing a regular GET request to any given path that you specify, you send the query as a query param, and then you get a response back. They have their own content type, and they also have cache control inbuilt, which I think is pretty cool. And then the content, the body of the response, is just your regular DNS message. So it's really replacing just the transport layer of this, right? And this is why implementing a server for DNS over HTTPS is fairly simple, because all of the web frameworks already exist, and you just take the body and put it to your existing DNS infrastructure. So let's get back to this example here for a quick second. When we talk about DNS over HTTPS, we only talk about this, right? Only this part of the whole communication will be encrypted. In this RFC and in the discussions I've seen up until today, like, none of this traffic is even mentioned. Like, this is not part of the RFC. And I don't know, like, really what to think about this. I think it's kind of weird to just leave it out, but it solves, like, a lot of the problems I mentioned before by just, you know, encrypting the customer side. And also, resolvers often have responses cached, right? Does it have problems? So are there any problems with DNS over HTTPS? And as I heard yesterday, whenever someone asks a question on the stage, the answer is probably yes. So there's a problem of tracking. And obviously, the resolver still sees every query. Every query you make to all the sites I've mentioned will at least be visible to your resolver. So, for example, if it's your ISP, they still see every site you visit. If it's Google or Cloudflare or PowerDNS, whoever you decide to be your resolver, they will see all your traffic, right? Or all the names to resolve, to be clear. Like, they don't see HTTP or any web traffic. They only see all the names you resolve and all the sites you visit. And this is something that bothers me. It really has all of HTTP, so it also supports cookies. It supports all the various techniques of fingerprinting, and it also is exposing the host via SNI. So this should be all of HVS, right? And I think that's weird. Like, we know how good the ad networks are in making you trackable with cookies, so we implement this mechanism in DNS. This is horseshit. I don't know. And this is a pretty controversial point whenever it comes to DNS over HTTPS, because this is not really part of the protocol, but to me, it's part of the same problem scope, right? Because with DNS over HTTPS, we often confuse this with what's called DNS over cloud or DOC, which basically means there's no way to discover these resolvers. There's no way, like DHCP, where you can ask a trusted authority, whatever that means, to ask for the resolver you should use in this use case. So the only option you have is either using a pre-configured resolver, and you can guess what Google Chrome, for example, would use as a pre-configured resolver, right? Or Firefox, or your operating system, or it again must be user-configured, and then, as we just saw in the previous example, like, you would use Google again, right? So I think, and again, this is not really part of the protocol, right? The protocol is not mentioning that you are all centralizing DNS, but due to the lack of discoverability, I think this is part of the problem. In the end, it all boils down to the one question: who do you trust? That's all I got. Thank you.